Okay, good morning, everyone, and welcome to the Broomfield Veterans Museum, or as we now call ourselves, the Veterans Museum Broomfield. At Lou? Thank you. But anyway.
Yes, I think this.
Can you?
Is this picking up?
Can you pick up my voice?
Yeah.
Okay. For the most part, this is for just helping with our recording versus needing to amplify in the room. But anyway, welcome to our 213th Coffee and Conversation.
Wow.
And again, as you can see, we're very fortunate to have Jim Watson joining us, who is a helicopter pilot during the Vietnam War. Chuck Robbins in the back. Chuck, raise your hand. Also was a Huey helicopter pilot. I think initially was a medevac, and then couldn't get enough and came back as a Cobra pilot. Chuck will join us again early next year with some of his videos he's taken. Just before we get going, I'd like to highlight our next couple upcoming talks. On the 13th, our next one is the 23rd of October. Don Seigen's going to be our speaker, and Don's been an Army veteran, a historian, teaches history down at DU, and is going to talk to us on his topic, Guadalcanal, the tipping point of World War II in the Pacific. So that'll be a most interesting talk for us. And then on 13 November, Wayne Luth will join us. Wayne is a World War II era veteran who was drafted like so many others and was being prepared for the invasion of Japan. Unfortunately, that did not have to occur, but Wayne and thousands of others, was signed to the 33rd Infantry Division and was involved in the occupation of Japan. So that'll be, most interesting for us as well. I would like to highlight on 11 November, Veterans Day, we will have a Veterans Day observance here at the museum starting at 11 a.m. outdoors. We've been guaranteed nice weather, and it'll involve patriotic music, displays, a guest speaker, and even the Broomfield Civic Chorus joining us. And then we'll have an open house in the museum along with refreshments. So we hope that you'll join us for that day as well. And then, let's see. Well, that'll kind of get us through November pretty well. So without further ado, Jim, please. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you, and thank you very much for all your assistance in helping to put this together, Michael. I really appreciate it. So this is a discussion about the importance of helicopters in Vietnam and also the first assault on Hamburger Hill. Obviously, that's a picture of me. It's taken at Fort Carson. When we arrived there, we had brand new H model Hueys. So we were really excited to have the best of the best at that particular time. The unit that I was assigned to was A Company of the 158th Aviation Battalion. And most of the people that was assigned to the company, I flew with in flight school, and I knew them. So we were really a close group of people. This is interesting how we ended up with that particular patch and how we ended up being called the Ghost Riders. There was kind of a mixed match in timing. We all showed up in early June. The unit wasn't fully formed until July. And so the major said to us, I don't want you guys hanging around and being obvious that you're not doing anything, right? So either you do something or you kind of disappear. And so we did more disappearing than we did other things. And so one day he said to the XO, where the hell are all these pilots? And he said, "Sir, they're ghosting," which means, you know, you can't see them. And so he said, "Go." I like that. I like that. And then the other guy said, "They're probably out riding their motorcycles too." So that's how we became known as the Ghost Riders. And of course, this is one of the horsemen of the apocalypse. And we had that painted on the underside of our helicopter. So when we were coming in, people could view that. Okay. Where's the switcher? He didn't give me the... Okay. Thank you.
Left and right.
Okay. This is really interesting, and I was kind of amazed by it when I put it together. There were 49,865 pilots trained during the Vietnam era. 2,191 pilots were killed. 2,712 crew members were killed. The other thing's kind of interesting, 151 students died in training. And we had a guy in our class who had been what they called recycled three times. He would flunk a particular session, they'd move him back. He really never should have been moved forward in the first place. He killed four people 2 days before we graduated in a final night flight. There was a total of 11,846 helicopters used in Vietnam. 5,300 were D models and H models. They became known as Hueys or Slicks. 1,423 B and C models primarily were gunships before the Cobra. 824 Cobra gunships. And then this is the job I wouldn't wish on anybody. 1,422 OH-6As, which were called Loaches. Out of that, 964 of them were lost, a very high number. And their job was to go out and find the bad guys. So they'd fly low level, going, "Ooh, here I am, take a shot." And they'd usually be followed by some Cobra gunships that were hanging around just in case. So, and the guy that painted this picture was in our unit. He's the one that painted and did the patch, the unit patch. After his time was up in Vietnam with the 101st, he extended for 6 months to fly a Loach and ended up spending the next year in a hospital in Honolulu. He was that badly shot up.
But he did recover.
He did recover, yeah. 5,600 helicopters were lost altogether. And this is the very important thing. This is the first time ever that helicopters had taken a primary role in military operations in combat. And because of the terrain, it was the only effective way to move troops and supplies around. So it really started the helicopters involved in combat. And in some cases, the war was even called the helicopter war. Okay, I heard warrant officers, I was a warrant officer candidate, started young, but I don't think they were quite that young. The little guy on here, that's my brother. The two of us were sitting in my dad's Jeep. He was a colonel stationed at Francis E. Warren in Cheyenne. So that's where I was born. And he wanted his two sons to follow in his footsteps, military career. So we rode around in his Jeep all the time. And since I was a slow learner, he sent me to a military high school. And it was a prep school for one of the academies. And it was heavy on military, a lot of military training. This was my graduation picture. I still hadn't got the point at that point.
Looks like you, handsome guy.
And so I think this is Fort Walters, where we did our initial training. And we had the TH-55 over here. What was it called? The Messerschmitt something or another?
Mitchell-Messerschmitt.
Yeah. And then on the other side, it had a 23 or 13, I'm not sure. But anyhow, this base is now closed. It was located in Mineral Wells, Texas. And this is the barracks that we stayed in. As you can see, I was a green hat. Different classes had different colors. My least favorite person was this guy right here, because he was known as a TAC officer. And they were the ones that were charged with instilling discipline to us when we weren't flying. And I think all of them were very angry that they weren't instructor pilots, that they were babysitters for a bunch of 18 and 19-year-old kids. Okay, this is the 55, and I got out of it, and I took a picture of it in this field, and this field's kind of amazing because I went to the University of Minnesota, and aviation was my minor, so when I went into the service, I already had a private pilot's license for airplanes. So my flight instructor, I'm 24, he's 19, just going to be 20, and he's teaching me how to fly. He did a year in Vietnam. And all the instructor pilots put money in a big jar. I think it was $25, they'd never tell us. And whoever student soloed first, that instructor pilot got all the money. So he worked real hard at selecting me because I was the only one with any kind of prior flight experience. And he used to take me to this field, and rather than fly around, learn traffic patterns, how to talk to the tower, you know, all the things the other students needed to learn for them to solo, all he did is throw out a soccer ball and have me push this soccer ball around the field so I could learn to hover. And one nice sunny Friday morning, not a cloud in the sky, no wind, no nothing, he said, let's do three touch and go. So we did that. Then he has me stop at the pad and says, okay, see you later, make me proud. So I did do my three passes, and I was the first to solo in my class. And I got thrown in the swimming pool there at the Holiday Inn. So it was kind of interesting. But I said, I got to come out and take a picture of this field. I forgot to bring a soccer ball, though. All right, and these are the blades. These are Huey blades that were sitting by the pool at the Holiday Inn in Mineral Wells. They are now located at the Vietnam Museum, which is just across the highway from where Fort Walters used to be. But when you soloed, and before they threw you in the pool, you got to walk through these blades. And there I am at Fort Rucker. This is what I took my instrument training in. When I graduated, there was about 500 people in the class, not just our company, but the whole thing. We were sitting in this large auditorium, and the general comes out and says, would Candidate Watson please come up on the stage? I said, why am I being singled out? Had no idea. Well, there's my dad, Mr. Military, who came out behind the curtain and swore me in as a pilot and as an officer. And he said it was one of the happiest days of his life, and I told him how much I appreciated it. But I got a lot of crap from the other guys. And I'll tell you a little story that adds on to it a little bit later. Okay, there we are again at the big party after graduation. And then they gave us our assignments. And of course, in the military, everything is done alphabetically. So they started reading off, Mr. Adams, you're going to Vietnam. Mr. Bravo, you're going to Vietnam. On and on and on. Everybody's going straight to Vietnam. And they got to Mr. Watson. You're going to Fort Carson, Colorado. My eyes got about that big. All my buddies start booing. some of the other people were also going to Fort Carson, and I said, I wonder if that guy over there is pulling any strings anyhow. I don't know how this is happening. And the reason for separating people and sending them to a stateside assignment, they either had a father or a relative or some close person to them that was already in Vietnam. And you remember after Saving Private Ryan, they never wanted to lose the last member of a family. So most of the people had a reason. I didn't have any reason at all. I always say, well, they got to the end, my name's Watson, they had an extra slot, they just put me in it. Okay, and this is Vietnam. The important thing here is it was broken down into four corps, and this is probably a better map. This is the DMZ here, and we were 27 miles from the DMZ at Camp Evans. And then there's Camp Eagle, and right over here is Hamburger Hill. We were there to support the 101st. And when we arrived, let me see if that's, yeah, here you can see the DMZ, Highway 1, Quang Tri. And then next to it, let's see, let me go back. Well, I'll just talk to you about it here. We had the DMZ, but anyhow, when we arrived at Camp Evans, the CBs had built the hangar, the revetments, the runway, but they forgot one important thing, and that was the hooches we were to live in. So when we arrived there, we flew up from...
use the laser pointer to show roughly
where it is?
Yeah.
You're probably right in this area right here.
Okay. So just off of Highway 1.
Yep. And so anyhow, when we arrived, the CBs were grading this dirt on a slight bluff. And we said, so where do we stay? And they said, well, they're going to be dropping off tents that we have to set up ourselves. So... no wooden floor, no nothing, we just put these tents. And we weren't getting our helicopters because our helicopters, we flew from Fort Carson out to Sacramento. We put them on an aircraft carrier, and the aircraft carrier took them to Vietnam. So we got there faster than they did, so we had to wait. We didn't have our helicopters for about 3 weeks. So for 3 weeks, we helped build our own hooches, fill the sandbags to put them around, and all the stuff that the CBs normally do, we were intimately involved in helping them because we wanted a place to sleep. Okay, this gives you some dates. The battalion, the 158th Aviation Battalion, was activated on July 25th, 1968, and was stationed at Fort Carson. Our mission was to train with the 101st Airborne as they transitioned from Airborne to Airmobile. Colorado Springs was picked because where we were going, I Corps, it's very similar with a lot of mountains. The training began in September of 1968, and we deployed to Vietnam in February of 1969. Now, when we got there, the 101st was stationed at Camp Eagle, and this little map here, we'll see it when we go along. Camp Eagle is right here, and that's where battalion headquarters was, and the 101st Division was stationed there. A Company of the 158th was stationed at Fort Evans. This is a picture of me. It was taken by a friend of mine just before I did my orientation and check ride in Vietnam. Even though I was an aircraft commander when I left Fort Carson and was assigned my own aircraft, I had to go through the orientation program when we got to Vietnam and take a check ride. And if you notice here, I'm wearing my so-called chicken plate. And that particular chicken plate was made by Coors, and it was made out of porcelain. Was yours? Do you remember?
Well, they're all aluminum backed ceramic. I didn't know where they were.
Yeah. Well, part of it was made by Coors as from some of the byproducts. Here are the hooches that we ended up building. As you can see here, there's a lot of, where is that little? There's a lot of sandbags. Every one of those sandbags was filled out by us. This just to go shows how self-sufficient we were. We gave ourselves haircuts. I mean, there was nothing there. We didn't have a shower. We really didn't have what you'd call an appropriate latrine. It was pretty basic living. But we also worked at improving that situation. The major came to me and he says, I'm giving you orders for things like generators, bed frames, mattresses, etc. And I don't care how you get them, just bring them back. So my co-pilot, his father was a W-4 in charge of supply down in Saigon. So we'd go down and see him, and we had a stack of requisitions. And one day we said, we really need a generator. He said, well, you're not going to get a generator unless you get aggressive. And we said, what does that mean? He said, well, at noon you go down to the dock, you pick a generator that's weight you can carry by a Huey, and you take it, no questions asked. If anybody asked me where the generator went, I got your orders right here, and I can say I gave it to you. So we did the same thing. Generator, mattresses, bed springs, all that stuff was done that way, and I got the award for being the scrounge officer. Okay, this is Camp Eagle. It's quite large. You can see all the hooches, the long runway, and that was located right here, very close to Way. And then this is where we resided at Camp Evans, much smaller. You can see the little tarmac over there where the planes are. We had Chinooks coming in and out with resupply. This is the maintenance area where the planes were repaired and maintained. We had revetments. And I loved revetments for two reasons. One, if they shot mortars in or whatever, it kept a lot of the shrapnel off the aircraft. But the other thing was if you were going forward or backing out and had a tail rotor failure, it prevented you from crashing. So I have this little tail rotor chain on my arm because I was backing out of there one day and lost my tail rotor. And of course, without a tail rotor, it'll spin. So I love revetments.
Well, we thought we'd give you an idea of Airmobile operations, along with some of the music, which we really enjoyed listening to. Let's see if I can pull that up. And this is the first camera. Whoa!
Did you notice how the troops were kind of jumping out? Because the plane never really landed, helicopter never really landed, except when you were picking up soldiers that were wounded. Okay.
Can I ask you a question?
Yes.
Were the helicopters that close to each other?
Oh, yeah. If we were very fortunate because our company commander was a former CAV pilot, and they really liked flying in formation. So you can see here, these are two of our helicopters going in. I'm the third one taking the picture. You can see the smoke where they're laying down suppressing fire. But that's about as close as we got, and that's a relatively small LZ. But when we were flying together, we were really pretty close. That way you weren't a single helicopter to shoot at. There were lots of them. So that's a typical LZ on the flatland.
Yeah. LZ means the
landing zone.
But you're most vulnerable just as you're approaching and getting ready to dump everyone off.
Right. And you didn't want to land because you don't know what they put in those landing zones. Now, we did something that was unique with our helicopters. You see the white stripe on the top? We painted a white stripe on the cabin, so if one of our birds went down and you saw a white stripe, you knew it was one of ours. And we went back regardless to get them. On the tail was a red ball. A company had a red ball. The other two slick companies had different colors. And the battalion had a white ball on the end. So if you saw a white ball with a white stripe, that meant somebody from the battalion had been shot down. And then, of course, we had the 101st Eagle right there on the tail. So our helicopters were pretty distinctive. And then right here, I don't know if you can all see it, but there was a little plaque right there by the aircraft commander's door, and that had everybody's call sign. My call sign was Rough and Ready. We're not going to explain how that happened because we'd be out here for an hour. And another interesting thing, my wife was involved with all these young officers at Fort Carson. She had just recently graduated from CU, ends up in Colorado Springs, and she's got a 100-to-1 ratio of young officers that she can date. And everybody in the company liked her so well, they gave her her own call sign. So when we go to our reunions, which we do every 2 years now, and they hand out the badges with the call signs, none of the other wives, none of the other significant others have a call sign, and they've all said, what's with her? And they said, well, she went through the whole thing with us at Fort Carson. And her call sign was Policewoman.
That's her?
This is her right there. Yeah. And so she has her own badge and her own call sign.
I was working for the juvenile probation department.
Yeah, I think that's why she got along with us. We acted like juveniles. Okay, here's a really good map that I found yesterday online. I'd been looking for something like it for a long time. But you can see the city of Huey right there. This was a famous beach, booby trap village, I think they called it. And then there was a beach right along here, Camp Eagle. The 101st headquarters was there, and the battalion headquarters for the 158th Battalion. Camp Evans, you can see where we were, way up there in the very forward end. And we also had a major battle on the 25th of April at Airborne, where we lost a few of our pilots and a few airplane. And Bagel, Bastogne, Birmingham, all of these were, if you can kind of, this is what this painting's trying to depict, the various fire bases that were in our area of operation. And then right down here is the Ashaw Valley, which was a big area for running supplies to the south down the Ho Chi Minh Trail. And then here's Hamburger Hill, or better known as Dong Ap Bai. If I may not be exactly perfect Vietnamese, but anyhow, that's where that was. So that puts it all in perspective. All right, here's the Ashaw Valley. I need to get my cheat sheet out here so I remember all this. And that's the infamous Hamburger Hill right there. You can see how heavily wooded it is and how steep it is. And it was, this is about sea level right here. And this is 3,074 feet at the top. So it's a very tall mountain. It's not connected to the one behind it. It was totally independent of it. This is the valley just as flat as you could be. And you'd see everything down here. You'd see North Vietnamese, Viet Cong, deer, pigs, everything you can imagine. And every time I went to a fire base and I hadn't been there in a week, we'd fly around the valley until we found a pig. We'd shoot the pig, land, put it in the back of the helicopter and bring it up to the fire base. We were really good buddies with those guys. They ate very well. And let's see, it's about from right here, this is going west. It was about a mile west of Laos, to give you the perspective of where it was. It was known as Dong Ap Bai, Hill 397, which was the military designation for it. The press ended up calling it Hamburger Hill, because from what I heard, they talked to a soldier that had been up there for 5 or 6 of the 10 days, and he said it's like ground hamburger up there. So that's how the press ended up calling it Hamburger Hill. And for some reason, one of the Vietnamese names for it is Crouching, the Crouching Beast. And the first, second lieutenant that landed or attempt at the very top, right up there. We had been bombing it with planes and artillery for days. But the thing is, they already knew we were coming. And I'll talk a little bit more about that later. But anyhow, the second lieutenant that spent a day and a half up there with about 22 people, right on the top of their headquarters, on top of that mountain, wrote this book, The Crouching Tiger. So if you really want to get, or the Crouching Beast, if you really want to get the whole story from a first-hand perspective, that's a good book to read. All right, so the assault on Hamburger Hill was known as Operation Apache Snow. And the official purpose of the operation was to cut off North Vietnamese infiltration from Laos and enemy threats to the city of Hue and Da Nang. That's how it was pitched, okay? The real reason was, the real reason was the second one. The general said the only significance of the hill was the fact that North Vietnamese were on it. The hill itself had no tactical value. A lot of generals and senior officers always wanted to have a major fight with an NVA unit. Typically what would happen is there would be small skirmishes. Very, very seldomly did you have a major, major battle between the two. And when the 101st realized how many people were around this area, they decided to take the North Vietnamese head on to prove that we could beat them in a battle. And it was kind of costly, but that was the real reason. Okay, this is a long.
Well, just highlight.
Yeah, so anyhow, the battle started on the 10th of May, very significant to me. because I'm the fourth ship of 100 helicopters. There's 100 helicopters lined up, and on the other side, there's 2,100 infantry soldiers ready to go. That gives you a concept of how big this operation was. And it wasn't just Hamburger Hill. There was a blocking force behind Hamburger Hill to the west to keep them from retreating. There was people down in the Ashaw Valley doing cleanup work. So it was a major, major battle. Lieutenant Colonel Honeycutt, he was what I call the command and control. He was a lieutenant colonel. He was in, I think, the 3rd Brigade of the 101st, and he's the one that flew command and control helicopter over the whole operation, and he kind of did the whole thing. And he was not a very well-liked guy, either at the beginning or at the end. So, and they did take on the Vietnamese 29th Regiment, and these were battle-hardened veterans of the Tet Offensive. So these were not patsies. These were hardcore NVA soldiers, and they had hardened bunkers in there. So it was pretty unbelievable. So the battle waged for 10 days. A lot of it was, that time was interrupted by rain that was so heavy you couldn't see in front of yourself in dense jungle. But it went back and forth, back and forth. And Honeycutt really wanted his troops to get to capture the hill as soon as they could. Primarily, and I don't know if you if your memories go back this well, but Ted Kennedy made a comment, look at all these people we're killing and we're never going to capture that hill. Well, the general didn't like that, and neither did the lieutenant colonel, so we were going to take that hill regardless of how many people were killed. So we finally took the hill 10 days later, and that was heavy airstrikes, artillery barrages, helicopters flying over, laying down, supporting fire, and infantry, 10 different infantry assaults. So we finally captured the hill after the 10th day. So that's May 20th. Well, because the hill had no significance whatsoever, on June 5th, we abandoned it. Does that make sense? It didn't make much sense.
Somewhere it's got a sling.
And you can see here, after all that, the North Vietnamese just went back up and reoccupied it a month later. And?
Well, the purpose of all of this was Westmoreland's approach to fighting the war, of trying to bleed the North Vietnamese, you know, dry, but that didn't work.
Yeah, everything that got reported, one of the major things was body count. Body count was a big deal. So you can see they suffered 638 North Vietnamese. I would say it was much higher than that, because the North Vietnamese, if they could, would take their dead with them. And the reason they would do that is because the American force would stack them up like lumber. So you might see a big open field with 200 people all stacked up on top of each other, and the American force was saying, that's what we did to you. So it was didn't make a lot of sense to me. We were fortunate that we only lost 72 soldiers, but we had 372 wounded, and a lot of those were severely wounded. Now, when we went in, we lost, in the lead ship was the company CO, company commander, Major Doherty. He had the XO with him. Major, major mistake. And on the manifest, the name Watson was supposed to fly. I was supposed to fly with the major, because he wanted to do the, he didn't want to be flying, he wanted to be doing the organization. But I think he did it, he didn't really want me, he wanted the XO, and the XO wanted to go. The XO was killed instantly when an RPG hit the ship. The Major Doherty was seriously injured and medevaced out and ended up going to Japan and then Hawaii. So in one little move, we lost our whole command structure. Now below those two people, a senior captain and a senior major were first lieutenants, and they didn't have a clue. Absolutely didn't have a clue. So the warrants got together and we said, we're going back out that afternoon and we're getting our people off the hill. Because we had 18 of our people on the top of that hill. And on top of that hill was the main command structure for this North Vietnamese regiment. We landed right on top of it. And now you'll see some pictures here later. But when we got back, another general came down, had us all line up. Had us all line up, and he gave us Bronze Stars, like handing out candy. Here's yours, here's yours, here's yours. And if I remember correctly, a couple people took theirs off and threw them. They said, we don't want these. We lost too many people. So there's the tail boom of one of our helicopters. This one must have been a battalion because it's got the white. But anyhow, the tail rotor was blown right off the back of the helicopter, probably by an RPG. Here's Major Doherty and Captain Watson's plane. No tail rotor on its side, all blown up. And then there's another helicopter just on the other side of it. But you can see how difficult it would be. We were told not to even think about touching the ground because look at all the wood. This is an LZ that was just blown that way by bombs. It was never really cleared. So there were branches and twigs and stuff. And when you went in, all this stuff was flying up, taking away your vision. And then here's another one that didn't even make it to the hill. And you can see one right there that lost its tail boom too.
You can see the density of the...
Yeah, the density of the terrain. And then there's the white stripe. White stripe there. So when we got back, we did this very early in the morning, and we got back without orders from anybody. We refueled the helicopters, and about 8 of us went back out to get our guys. And Honeycutt saw us coming and said, if you guys land there, you're all going to be court-martialed. So he said, we've made the decision not to land any more helicopters in there. So an interesting story. One of the helicopters had got their hydraulics shot out. So the hydraulics didn't work, so the plane was basically flyable, but it didn't have hydraulics. And it was still sitting in the LZ, and it was operational. So Bill Parsons, the guy that it was in our group, went over to one of the other helicopters with his crew chief, who was also a maintenance guy, and they took the hydraulics out of that, and as much hydraulic fluid as they could, took it back, put it in his helicopter, and took out all the injured soldiers. And that was his first of three Silver Stars. Yeah. He was a real, real hero, and he didn't care if he got killed or not. So, and he was told, because when Colonel Honeycutt saw the blades moving, he told them to shut it down and not take off, or he was going to be court-martialed too. And Parsons said, you know, he kept working with the mic like there was static. Can't hear you. And he flew out. So he was totally prepared to take whatever punishment they were going to give him. And the next day he got a Silver Star. So here's how it was reported in the news. This is what we had to listen to as soldiers in Vietnam fighting for our country. And my birthday was May 10th. Did I tell you that? I wasn't too happy. I'm the fourth ship of 100. That means I go in pretty early on my birthday.
What was the length of those blades, that top blade?
I don't know. Do you remember? 48 foot.
From one to the other.
48 from one end to the other, or 48 total, one end to the other. 24 foot blades. 24 foot blades, okay. Oh, okay. Here we go. Well, Hamburger Hill began on May 10th, 1969, occupying a prominent position in the Arshore Valley in South Vietnam, a major supply route for the regular North Vietnamese troops. The mountain was known locally as the Mountain of the Crouching Beast, designated as Hill 937 by the United States Army. The men of the 101st Airborne Division who fought there rechristened it Hamburger Hill. U.S. efforts to seize Hamburger Hill were undertaken as part of Operation Apache Snow, a coordinated attack by the U.S. and South Vietnamese against North Vietnamese troops in the Arshore Valley. The aim was to interdict North Vietnamese bases and supply routes further south. U.S. intelligence was in short supply and necessitated large numbers of infantrymen on the ground. Multiple attempts to seize the hill, which held little real strategic value beyond its prominent position and the fact of enemy troops occupying it, met with heavy casualties. Press interest grew as the fighting peaked and the term Hamburger Hill was coined to describe the carnage. Over 10 days, more than 70 Americans were killed and nearly 400 wounded, with many at home questioning the loss of life as something that was debatable in absolute military terms. The apparent futility of the fighting for the hill later abandoned as the U.S. Army withdrew from the Arshore Valley helped underscore the war weariness of the public at home, unfamiliar with the tactics and the strategies of the war in Vietnam. Join us next time for another segment of This Week in Military History with the Pittsfield Military Museum and Library.
Okay, the lessons learned, at least from my perspective. Why we went to Vietnam in the first place? Well, I think you've heard these reasons before, right? The Gulf of Tonkin, where we were having issues with North Vietnamese ships in the Gulf of Tonkin. Was that really enough reason to go to war? The domino theory, and that's one of containment. If one country falls to the communists, there'll be others that will fall subsequently. So those were the two major reasons. Now, as far as I'm concerned in this particular battle, why did we lose all these people in this major battle when it had no strategic value whatsoever? Initially, we were told that they were going to probably use it as a fire base. Now, if they had done that and stayed there and used it as a fire base, they could have had more coverage, complete coverage of this particular area in the north, in the Arshore Valley. Faulty intelligence can kill, and I remember Major Doherty telling me and a few of the other pilots the day before, he said, "I don't like the intelligence we're getting out of headquarters. I think this is going to be a much bigger deal than they're making it out to be." And he was exactly right. And when I left this company, because we all went over as a unit, so we couldn't all go home at the same time. So after this major battle, it kind of shook up the whole group. A new major came in, nobody liked them. It was a unit in total turmoil. And so they said, "Who wants to be infused?" I raised my hand. And so they sent me down to 2 Corps, to 268th Aviation Battalion. And it was the largest aviation battalion in Vietnam at the time. And the colonel says to me, I don't need a pilot. I don't know why they sent you here. And I said, "Well, what am I supposed to do?" He said, "I know you're only a warrant, but how would you like to be the battalion S2? Which is the intelligence officer. And you're just going to do it until I can get a captain or a major to fill the slot." Well, 7 months later, I left the 268th Aviation Battalion as the S2 as a W-2. I absolutely love the job. They gave me my own helicopter, my own crew. Everything was consistent. I had an interpreter. I had a security guy. And we went around with bags full of money and met with, you know, just like they're doing in Afghanistan and Iraq. You know, you go in and you try to get information from various local people, and to reward them, you give them money, and they use that money to, I don't know, build another school or whatever. But, I mean, everybody knew what was going on. But I loved the job. I reported the information I got, somewhat filtered, to battalion. And they must have felt that it was probably the best intelligence they were getting, so I ended up keeping the job, and I loved it. And a week before I was to leave, they offered me a direct commission to captain, from W-2 to captain. The MOS was going to be infantry. And I said, so how much longer, if I take it, how much longer? And they, well, we'll add 2 additional years. So now I had 3 years. Don't you think I'd go back to Vietnam as probably an infantry captain one of those days? So I said, no, I think I'll just stay a W-2 pilot. I'll see you later. That didn't go over real well, but anyhow. Be careful of losing your command structure. We already talked about that, because we were really adrift for about a month. And the new major lasted about a month, and he was sent back to battalion. So it was in real disarray for several months. Who can you really trust? There was a lot of discussion after this that there was a mole at the 158th Battalion headquarters and division who was feeding information to the Viet Cong and the North Vietnamese on every mission we were doing. And of course, you can't tell a good guy from a bad guy. And so that was a real issue. And what's the hurry? Well, I put that down because if it was left up to Honeycutt, he would have fought 24/7 to get to that hill 5 days earlier than he did. And he didn't care how many people he killed. And if you read this book, you'll find out that there was a bounty on his head. The enlisted men had a very large bounty on his head. They hated him. So we never should have got there. And then, of course, weather played a major, major factor. If you see the movie that they did in the mid-80s, you can just see how the rain was coming down. With the dense forage and the rain, you couldn't see anything. There I am. And what I put there is, look at how relaxed I am. I'm going home tomorrow. And I went from sleeping in that lousy little tent that you saw earlier. If you look over here, see what it says right there? CW2 Watson, I had my own little room. Air conditioned, TV, everything. So I was a happy camper. So that's it. Is there any questions? Oh, let me talk, well, yeah, this we talked about before. I think the most important thing on this slide, and that's why we put it in twice, is this is the first time helicopters took a primary role in combat, and they've maintained that role ever since. But are there any questions that anybody has?
What was your scariest flight you did?
Oh, that, without a doubt, this was the scariest flight I ever had. I picked up 2 critically wounded soldiers, and I was just coming back from what they called an ash and trash. I brought out the mail, the food, supplies, stuff like that. I was flying down Highway 1, and I got there was a call out for a medevac. I didn't fly medevac. I flew assault helicopters. But anyhow, I was the closest one. They said it was a hot LZ, but 2 critically wounded soldiers. And I had a guy next to me that was in country 2 weeks. He was clueless. I mean, and he said, sir, you can't go in there. We're going to get killed. Why would you do that? You're going home in a week. And I said, because 2 people are there. So anyhow, long story short, we went in. We did take fire. They got the 2 people on. And the medevac, or the guy that was taking care of him, hopped on, and he told me that we needed to go out to the Repose, which was a hospital ship out in the ocean. So we're flying out to the ocean. It's starting to get dark. I've never landed on the back of a ship in my life, ever. And they didn't teach it in flight school, right? So I'm flying out there, and I'm looking around. We finally find the ship, because it's starting to get really, really dark. And this ship is going like this and like that. And on the back was a Red Cross, big white Red Cross. And so we figured out what the frequency was to get contact with the ship. And a guy came out. He said, "I'll be standing out there with these flags. Do what I tell you to do." So anyhow, the ship's doing this. And finally, you know, after several attempts to land, he said, he told me to just hold right at where I was, and the ship came up and met my skids. So I just dropped the collective, and now that was the scariest. The second scariest was taking off. The ship's going into the wind, right? And it's darker than you know what. So I take off, do a pedal turn, because otherwise I'm going to hit the superstructure. Do a pedal turn and go like this, and I'm just going down, 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 down. Can't see the water. Pulling this thing, trying to get all the power I could. Didn't hit anything, but that was scary. Yeah, I'd never do that. Did you ever land on a hospital ship?
Not me. I was going to tell you that I went to aviation cadets and Air Force, and all the things you said about your experience going through pilot training, it was exactly the same. Alphabetical, first the soil, into the water tank. I went to find helicopters, so you didn't have to worry.
Chuck, did you experience some?
I landed on a few ships in April 1967, two B-52s collided 46 nautical miles southeast of Vung Tau, off the coast of Vietnam. I and many other Army helicopters were called to go out and look for survivors. There were no survivors, but we were out 46 miles, no flotation gear whatsoever.
Yeah.
You know, if anything happened to that single engine helicopter, they'd be looking for us. But anyhow, as a result of that, we all had to learn how to land on Navy ships. And in Vung Tau Harbor, which is a resort area in Vietnam, near Saigon, we all got qualified to, you know, the green button or red button or whatever it is they call you. You know, you're cleared to land, so we did approaches. And then later on, with the Riverine Force on the Mekong River, I landed on some barges.
Wow. Yeah, it was an interesting experience.
Well, Jim, thank you so much for joining us. We want to give you one of our challenge coins.
Oh, good. Thank you. I appreciate it. I got a beautiful challenge coin here. You see ours?
Oh, yes. Oh, yeah. Wow, that's marvelous. Yes.
Yeah.
Well, one thing I just want to end up. Another story. I wasn't directly involved in this, but literally 1 year later after Hamburger Hill, the 101st again went back into the Osha Valley. This time they occupied what was called Hill 927, just about 15 kilometers from Hamburger Hill. This time it was a hilltop that had become denuded because we previously occupied. And the idea was we were going to seize that hill again, fortify it, bring in an artillery battery, and use that to start attacking what we saw was obvious movement down the Osha Valley. The complication was, for any of these hills, it looked probably just like that, 927, except surrounding by other hills. All the hills in the Osha Valley in many areas, the only way you can resupply them is by helicopter. Come winter time, the weather goes bad. So in all those areas in which we're, you know, which Jim was pointing out, come winter time, we withdraw from all those areas. Well, what the North Vietnamese did is they fortified every hill around them. And not only that, when you can fortify the hill, you
can then zero in all your orders and everything onto that hill. So you knew exactly where everything was. So what did we do? The 101st, once again, flew in, brought an artillery battery, set up the hill here, and come 1 July, they got pummeled because the North Vietnamese all around it had it zeroed in. They knew everything. So what did we do? We brought in another battalion, 2 battalions, to attack the hills around it. Well, the same way. All those hills had bunker complexes and everything. During a 40-day period, I had 6 of my classmates killed in the fighting here, 3 others mortally wounded. And literally, we suffered the same level of casualties as Hamburger Hill. And then we withdrew. And we had to withdraw because we couldn't hold it. But the interesting thing is, this particular battle by the 101st received literally no news in by local news reporters. That's because the divisions to the south, which included my division, was invading Cambodia. And that's where all the news guys went. And then immediately afterwards, the 101st just shut down any discussion about what went on here. But again, it was as if we hadn't learned anything of a lesson from what we had just been doing. So it's not surprising, a lot of bitterness by many of the troops who were forced to kind of go through this. So anyway.
Were you Army?
Yes, yeah. At that time, I commanded a combat engineer company in the 25th Infantry. So I was over there at the same time, but in the south part.
Wow.
Yeah, Chuck, you did.
When this occurred, this Hamburger Hill occurred, I was back in the States at Fort Rucker. But I remember when this occurred, there was a lot of news stateside about what a useless thing this really was. And I think that's really what contributed to getting Westmoreland replaced.
Yes.
By General Abrams.
Well, there's a nice book about From the Jaws of Victory, and one of the generals in that book is Westmoreland.
Yeah. Well, there's another good book called The General Who Lost Vietnam, and it's kind of the story of Westmoreland and how we evolved into a war of attrition.
Just one last thing.
Yes.
When they talk about Hill 916 and all these other hills with a number,
yep.
That's the elevation
right.
of the hill
yep.
in meters.
Yes.
Yep.
That's what that means.
Yep.
They say hill 415, 6.54,
yeah.
whatever they're saying, that's the elevation of the hill.
Thank
yeah.
you.
Glad you brought that up. Thank you.
But they also obviously had a Vietnamese name as well for most of them.
I did too.
Yeah. Well, thank you very much for joining. Come speak with Jim some more, Chuck there. Any of us visit the Vietnam room upstairs. We also have some other videos there which talk about air mobile operations and stuff. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
How did we do time-wise?
Great, man.
Pretty good.
Just right.
Yeah, good. Well, thank you.